to sing for you again, because the second Sunday is the national saints. So today would be the American saints, and also we count the Romanian saints and all the Balkan saints. But in each of the churches, they commemorate their national saints. Do we have American saints? Yeah, you know where they are in the church? Left and right, both of those icons are all the American saints. There are 30 of them. And there are another 15 waiting to be glorified by the church. So today I'm going to talk to you about the typical meaning of saints, not the one that we used last week about we're all saints, we're all potentially saints. But there are those who are specifically glorified by the church and recognized as saints from the consensus of the people. And of those 30 saints of America, many of them were born abroad, obviously. But many of them are Alaskan natives, Native Americans, born in Alaska. Some of them were born in America as even ethnic. We have a Serbian saint and a Greek, a couple of Serbian saints who were born in America. And at least five of them are converts to the faith, Americans of whatever ethnicity. They're not all bishops. They're not all priests. We have a Matushka, a Priftasa up there, Olga of Alaska, who was so good to the people that she became a saint. People recognized her as a saint, and the church glorified her as a saint. Sarah Pimeroz, who was a grew up an evangelical of some kind, became a Buddhist, became an Orthodox monk, and is recognized as a saint throughout the Orthodox world. We have Greeks and Romanians, Serbians, Syrians, Alaskan natives. No Albanian, I'm sorry. Syrians, Russians, Arpeco-Russians, Ukrainians. We'll wait for an Albanian. But these are people who were recognized for their holiness in life. And I mentioned it today because today it's very appropriate, being the 4th of July and honoring the American saints. We live in this country that was founded on God-given principles. Now I know our church father said separation of church and state, but that meant that there would be no state church, that everybody would be free to worship in their own way. It didn't mean that we separate the state from any kind of religion, meaning that religion is not acceptable in public. That's not what they had in mind at all. As a matter of fact, they called upon God many times. They even wrote in all their writings that this nation is founded upon God. And I have to say that we can say that this nation is founded upon Judeo-Christian principles, meaning the Old Testament and the New Testament, those principles that God gave us through the Ten Commandments, and all through those laws that were given, this nation was founded upon. As a matter of fact, they've tried to remove "In God We Trust," but it hasn't been. It's even on our money. Do we trust in God? I hope so. But lately, we've come across this endeavor to not even mention religion in government. You know, they banned benedictions at graduation ceremonies. You know what the kids have done? They sneeze so they can get a "God bless you" from the people. Our country is the beacon, at least has been, the beacon of light to the whole world. And the reason they said separation from church and state was that they separated from England. England's church was the Church of England. You had to be a member of the Church of England. You had to practice that way, and if you weren't, you were considered maybe even persecuted. You were even considered outside of the realm of citizenship of that country. Roman Catholics were persecuted in Great Britain if the king was an Englishman of the Church of England and not of the Catholic Church. So the Puritans and all those who left England came to this country to establish a country where they could worship freely. Unfortunately, as happens many times, even the persecuted become persecutors when they get their freedom. So people had to leave Massachusetts, and Thomas Hooker had to form Connecticut, Roger Williams had to form Rhode Island, because they were Baptists, and they weren't free to practice their religion among the Puritans. William Penn founded Pennsylvania so the Quakers could worship freely. And the Catholics founded Maryland so they could worship freely. The Swedish Lutherans went to Delaware, and everybody had their own little thing. It was never intended to be that way. It was intended to be freedom of worship, just like our ancestors came from Europe and they built their churches. They were not required to become Protestant or Roman Catholic. They were allowed to have their own churches. Okay, they were laughed at, they were persecuted, but hey, we all went through that. But they built their churches, they built their communities. We have them today, almost 100 years here. The Greek church, 100 years. We've been here in America, and we have our saints, and we were allowed to flourish. Now, I want to tell you, last week, to show how far Orthodoxy has come, because we've been here a little over 200 years, starting from Alaska. It wasn't America then, but when we took it over, that became part of us. How far we've come. Last week, an auxiliary bishop was consecrated in Texas, who grew up a Presbyterian, and he became the bishop of Fort Worth, Texas. The Archbishop of the South, of the Diocese of the South, is the Archbishop of Dallas, Texas. In the OCA, of which we're a part of, that has been established 50 years ago, it's an autonomous, independent church of America. We don't have a foreign ruler. We don't have a foreign patriarch. We don't pay allegiance to Romania, to Constantinople, to anybody, or to Moscow. We are independent. Our metropolitan is the head of the church. Our last two metropolitans were Episcopalians in Washington, D.C. Our Archbishop Nathaniel is a convert from Catholicism. His family was strongly anti-Orthodox. He became a bishop. And his friend, who was a monastic with him at the same time, who became the bishop of the Albanians, was a Lutheran. Archbishop Melchizedek of Western Pennsylvania was a Lutheran minister. And Mark, the bishop of Eastern Pennsylvania, was born a Roman Catholic, grew up a Pentecostal, and now he's an Orthodox bishop. Archbishop Dimitrie, who was one of the saints, was the Archbishop of the South, was a Baptist, and became Orthodox. Over half of our OCA hierarchs and clergy are converts to the faith. Half of the people in the OCA are converts to the faith. There was a great bringing together in the late 1800s, early 1900s, when those Catholics of Byzantine Rite returned to Orthodoxy, and they became this foundation of the OCA. And then in the 80s, the evangelicals who became Orthodox in large numbers began their parishes, and they started missions throughout the United States. When our folks came, there were parishes in Massachusetts, Connecticut, Rhode Island, New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, Chicago, and California, a few. Today, there are Orthodox parishes in every state of the Union. Every state of the Union. And many of those parishes are completely American. Not ethnic at all. Using English in their services, and they were all converts. The church has come this far, and it has a long way to go. Now, we never know how many of us there are in this country. Estimates range from 3 to 7 million. That's a big range, but it's still very minuscule compared to the 300 million or more people in the United States. But I believe firmly firmly that Orthodoxy has something to offer to America, that America is missing. And we see it in the life of the Orthodox countries, where in spite of all their persecution, our people lived under the Muslim occupation for 500 years. My father, like so many men, had crosses tattooed on their forehead and on their hands so that the Turks would take them, showing that they were Christians. And they came to this country to find that freedom. And then under communism, but the church continued to exist. The church flourishes in those countries. Why? Because Christ is there. And those people who didn't really believe, or were just part of the, say, we just go to church, they fell off the wayside. But the ones who lasted, who went through the concentration camps, the ones who were really suffering, they're true Christians. And they believed, and their faith kept them going. I tell you this story, remember when Father Peter Gilchrist came. He was a Swedish Lutheran, and he was the leader of the evangelicals when they became Orthodox. 2,000 people became Orthodox at that time, evangelical. And he came to speak at our parish, remember? There were 200 people in the hall. There were ministers who had come from other parts. There were people who were not Orthodox to listen to him. And I said to him, I said to the audience when I introduced them, I said, shame on us that we never went after these people to bring them to the church. And you know what he said? Don't castigate yourself, because we wouldn't have listened. When the time was right, when the Holy Spirit thought the time was right, we came. And this is true. This is something that we have to pray for the mission of the church, not in foreign lands, but in America. And not just for Orthodoxy, but for faith to establish itself in the United States, in America, where we can stand up and say, listen, we have a faith. We're not ruled by the minority. We're not going to be not putting up our Christmas displays because 100 Buddhists don't like it. Because this country is majority Christian. Now, we're not forcing it down their throats, of course not. We're not forcing anybody to convert to Christianity. We allow everyone to worship as they will. But please allow us to express our faith in public, because this is who we are. And I told you that at the Easton parade, I don't know why they're still allowed to do that, but there are two people, one minister and myself, who go there and give the prayer for the parade. One begins the parade and one ends it. And the people love it. And nobody's complained so far, like, why do you have that? Because that's who we are. That's who we are. Express your faith in public and let the people know that this is a separation of church and state. It doesn't mean that there's no religion in the state. It means that no one is above the other, and that we're all equal and allowed our own ways. But we're all allowed to express that worship and that belief of ours in public, so that we know that the United States is the beacon of faith. For many, many years, we were considered the most religious country in the world. Can you believe that? If you remember, in the 50s, the golden age of the parishes, when our Sunday schools were full of children and people were coming to church and churches were being built, it was over 75% of the people went to church on a weekly basis. Today, that's way, way down. And not just because of the pandemic, it's because of the effects of this, not persecution, but seduction to take us away from our faith. It would be better if we were persecuted. We would stand up for our faith. But because we're seduced, we are seduced by materialism and all those things of the world that take us away from the church. So this is my 4th of July speech. With the American saints, we have become a mature church, worthy of being autocephalous, independent, being our own American. American church. And to be our own American church doesn't mean that we have to give up whatever our ethnicity is. I mean, I use Romanian and Greek in the service today, and we use mostly English. People can still use their languages, their culture, but we are in America to stay. I don't know, is anybody going back anywhere? No, everybody's here to stay. Even our parents came here to stay. They weren't going to go back. They accepted this land. They loved this land. They loved America. My father loved America. All of our parents did. All of our grandparents did. They said, there's no place in the world like this. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let's keep it that way. Let's keep it that way. Instead of doing it at the end, let's do it now. We'll sing that part. God.